Hello, welcome to Back to Basics. In this episode, we are going to talk about database sharding to horizontally scale your relational databases. 4 years ago, I was working with a last mile delivery customer who were dealing with database scalability challenges. They had a very good problem, that is, significant growth in number of customers in a short amount of time. They implemented different design patterns to increase system throughput, that is, adding more read replicas, leveraging cache for frequently accessed data, and partitioning and archiving data. It worked for a few months, but the growth of database was reaching vertical limits, and they need to plan for additional growth. This is when they considered horizontal database sharding. Let's look at a similar customer use case. Here is an example of a typical e-commerce application with a three-tier architecture. The architecture includes web tier that interacts with order management application and backend databases to complete order lifecycle. As e-commerce companies acquire new users, database size and number of database requests per second increase for their order database. As the number of incoming orders increase, database size grows along with increase in number of database requests, increasing the average response time until it reaches an inflection point when the response time goes beyond the client timeout and client request starts to fail. In this situation, you can upgrade database instances from a smaller to a larger instance to handle additional user traffic, but you will reach vertical limits eventually. When the limits are reached, you still face increased average response time. This phenomena can also be explained with Little's law. It says, as the average number of requests being processed and average rate of incoming requests increase, the average time it takes a request increases. Now let's look at how it works when we do horizontal scaling instead of vertical scaling. As the number of order increases, you distribute the order across multiple database shards. The number of incoming database requests per shard is still within the limits and average response time doesn't go beyond client timeout. As you expect more orders to process, you can add more shards without affecting customer experience. Now, there are a number of sharding techniques that you can use to shard your database. Identifying the right technique requires you to consider first, cardinality, which is possible values of the shard key. Second, frequency, which is probability of storing specific information in a particular shard. There are different types of sharding techniques: key-based, range-based, hash-based, and geo-based. Here is the customer order database, which has customer ID, order ID, and number of the other calls. The cardinality of customer ID in this example is 20. Let's take average number of orders per customer to be balanced across the first 10 customers and the next 10 customers. We split the customer database using customer ID as the shard key with range-based partitioning. Once you have identified sharding method and database design, the next step is to implement, which requires some changes on the application layer. You need to build, reuse a proxy layer that's responsible for properly routing database requests from application layer to database shards. A number of database engines natively don't support sharding. So you need to use a proxy layer to do a lookup and properly request database requests to a shard. Some database engines such as PostgreSQL have open source proxy implementation, such as pgcat, for you to use when choosing database sharding as your scalability design. It brings additional complexity of maintaining shards and resharding database in case of hot spotting. AWS reduces a lot of maintenance operational overhead by removing heavy lift of database maintenance activities. You need to watch for hotspot. It's possible that certain shards are accessed more frequently than the others, leading to uneven resource utilization and possible performance impact. In this case, shard 2 gets accessed more frequently and as can be seen from the number of orders. If hotspotting starts impacting your performance, you have to reshard with a new shard key, possibly order ID in this case. Lastly, your application complexity increases due to the introduction of a proxy layer. Now, coming back to our original application design, let's see how it looks when we have multiple shards on Amazon RDS. You introduce another RDS instance independently functioning as a shard. The shard leverages high availability best practices of multi-AZ and additional read replicas. Afterwards, you add a proxy layer to map shards to ranges or hashes or something else depending upon your sharding technique. As you may have noticed, you can add virtually as many shards as possible, but AWS service limits still apply. You need to check for those limits when building your sharding strategy. After sharding, you comparatively have a smaller number of rows per shard, and queries will take less time to execute in comparison to all queries running on the same database. Along with performance, it provides higher resiliency as if a database shard experiences any issues. You can still process customer orders and avoid complete disruptions. From a security standpoint, it reduces blast radius if a database shard is compromised. In summary, it's a good design pattern when you have already utilized all other design patterns and are still facing database scaling challenges. You will need to spend most of the time coming up with a scalable sharding strategy to accommodate for growth for many years to come. Check out the links below for more details. Thanks for watching Back to Basics. See you next time.